Hello, everybody. We are going to get started kind of on this. I guess it's kind of like the real first lecture, but we're going to get started with archaeology. As mentioned in the introduction to the four fields, there are four fields, and I figure no better place to start than archaeology, the most popular one. Okay. So this is based off of chapter six that I posted in the weekly folders. So please take a look at that. But let's get started. Can you guys see this? I'm concerned that you cannot see this. Yes, okay. So, quick think about question. Archaeology is largely about understanding our past. What are some of the obvious difficulties that arise in trying to investigate the past? Think in practical terms, right? So, when we're investigating the past, right, the whole point of archaeology is to kind of like understand how our ancestors lived, right? So, what are some of the challenges of doing that? Right off the bat, just from this is obviously a question to kind of guide the takeaways from this lecture. But I also want you to think, just even at this point, what's hard about archaeology and actually what separates it again from social cultural anthropology is that there's we're studying people that literally aren't around anymore, right? So there's no one that you can talk to. And with that, usually there is nothing or not as much of their life that you can see, right? So today's, for example, for Kingsborough, right? Like if you were to find people that went to Kingsborough, Kingsborough would still be there today, right? Their record might still be in the system. They might whatever, right? There's still evidence of their livelihood today. For a lot of archaeology, a lot of that stuff isn't there. Okay. All right. So what do our, oh wait, actually, you know what? Let me just quickly do announcements. I don't know why there's not an announcements page here. But so at the end of this week, quiz three is due. Yeah, that's pretty much it. Just make sure to get the quizzes done. The reflection two is not going to be due until next Friday, so you're cool on that for now. Yeah. That's pretty much it. So weekly quizzes, and then there's a reflection at the end of every section, basically, which if, in this case is just going to be 2 weeks. Okay. And as always, if you have any questions, just shoot me an email, you'll be good to go. Okay. All right. So what do archaeologists do? Archaeologists analyze material traces of human activities. They analyze the modification of the physical environment. They use the archaeological record to interpret cultural diversity and change, and they finally provide illumination on past forms of human culture that do not exist today. Okay, so analyze material traces of human activities. That's pretty obvious, right? That's like looking at stuff like pots and pans and digging them up. But this is a little bit different. Modification of the physical environment. So there are many instances where, for example, let's say a bunch of people lived in a cave, right? They obviously modified the cave for their lifestyles, right? The most stereotypical image that you probably have is like them drawing on the cave walls, right? But there also could be other things. They might have brought in, I don't know, tree stumps to sit on, or they might have created little beds of leaves to sleep on. Who knows, right? But technically, are they like making anything? Not really, but they are modifying the environment. And that's something that archaeologists also look at, okay? Yeah. So what approach do archaeologists take, right? They usually reconstruct, sorry, their main goal is to reconstruct the past, okay? But specifically reconstructing life ways and or basically like understanding the culture of the past, right? And that's very important. Again, I need to emphasize this because it's not just about finding old things, right? It's about understanding like what can this old thing say about this group of people that lived, you know, I don't know, like 300, what's it called, like 1,000 years ago or whatever. What can this thing say about their life, right? So things are very interesting. Like, you know, let's say you find like a wagon. Like, was the wagon used for farming? Was the wagon used to bring stuff to a market to sell? Was the wagon used to, you know, I don't know, to carry things to a market that where other groups traded? We don't know, right? But that's the main goal, is to reconstruct the life way or the culture of the past. Okay, so these two things here explain cultural processes that created their culture, processual archaeology, and focusing on interpretive archaeology, post-processual archaeology. So cultural process, so basically what happened was Actually, it's more specific over here. Yeah. So processual archaeology views archaeology as an objective empirical science. They use mathematics to examine distribution of material and remains over space and time. They emphasize human adaptation to different environments, right? So processual archaeology is basically what archaeology was before post-processual came around. And it focused on the math kind of like hard science aspects of it, right? So like, oh, this, I don't know, this pot that we found is made of this type of clay, which means that they had the technology to use fire in this way. They, they're so and so amount of feet away from the river, and so they created these types of things for fishing. It's very math and hard science based, but eventually people came through and were like, yo, like, math and, the practical aspects of your environment does not dictate everything you do. A lot of people in New York, which is on a coast, right? A lot of people in New York do not eat seafood, despite being right next to an ocean. So using those types of things, just those types of things to describe people's lifestyles is a little bit lacking, right? And so that's when they came with post-processual archaeology, which emphasizes human agency and the power of ideas and values when studying past cultures, right? Stress symbolic and cognitive aspects of societies, and examine power, domination, internal contradictions within a society from the archaeological record. So basically what this is it doesn't just look at the thing that they found, right? It doesn't just use math and science to look at stuff. It also tries its best to understand the whole society, right? So like maybe if they see certain types of, I don't know, certain types of chickens, right? And the chickens, funny enough, were not eaten. Right, whenever we found the carcasses or they were completely whole, they weren't cut up, they weren't gnawed through. So maybe we can assume that they had some kind of religious association with chicken. Like chicken is like, I don't know, super, godly in some way, right? But the main point again is to add that extra layer of interpretation to the stuff you find, because again, when we live our lives, it's not just about what is mathematically practical. There's a lot of things that add to our, human experience, right? And so that will also be true for civilizations that are 1,000 years old. Okay. Can you guys hear me? I just want to make sure you guys can hear me. Yes, you can. Okay. So the archaeological record, and this is the stuff that archaeologists basically look at, right? There are four things: artifacts, ecofacts, features, and sites. Artifacts are portable objects made, used, or modified by hominins. Ecofacts are plant or animal remains that are byproducts of hominin activities. Features are non-portable remnants of hominin activities, such as walls, ditches, or mounds. And sites are geographic locations within remains of past activities. So artifacts are portable objects used or modified by humans, right? Pots, pans, weapons, whatever. Ecofacts are plant or animal remains that are byproducts of hominin activity. So ecofacts are a little bit more special. They have to be leftovers of a plant or an animal. So like, for example, this is an easy example. Let's say they eat a lot of beef and you find beef bones, right? Because they didn't eat the bones, obviously. That is an ecofact, okay? Features are non-portable remnants of hominin activities, such as walls, ditches, or mounds. And finally, sites are basically where you find these things, right? And so artifacts and ecofacts, I can explain them pretty well. Features are basically unmovable things, right? So artifacts are very movable, swords, pots, pans, necklaces, whatever, right? But features are unmovable, right? So the examples they have here are walls, ditches, or mounds, which are good examples, right? You cannot move a whole freaking wall. I guess technically you could, but I like to give a better example, which is something like a grave site, right? You cannot move the grave site unless you literally move the whole, area where the graves are built, right? Because it's kind of built into the ground, essentially, right? So features are things that are unmovable. Of course, the most famous ones are like the pyramids and stuff like that. You cannot move the pyramids, and that is a feature. Okay. So this is the stuff that archaeologists look at, or sorry, analyze. Preservation. So while we're talking about the things that archaeologists look at or what they dig up and stuff like that, it is important to keep in mind the preservation factors, meaning that these things affect the way they are maintained or not maintained. So organic versus inorganic remains. What do you think lasts longer in the ground? A chicken bone or a wooden, spatula? Obviously the wooden spatula, right? So if the thing used to be alive, it will not last as long in the ground as things that are not alive. That's it, right? So, yeah, I'll talk about why it's important in a second. Very cold, very dry, or wet climates, okay? So, very cold places like Siberia, Alaska, Antarctica, great places to preserve things, right? Very dry, places like Arizona, right? The Gobi Desert. Yeah, whatever, right? Things with like very low humidity. And finally, the opposite of that, places with very high humidity, such as Florida, right? Or the rainforest, right? Amazon rainforest. These are very humid places. Now, you'll be asking, like, why is it so these it sounds like they're describing everywhere, but it's not, right? So, like, for example, places that I just mentioned, Arizona, Siberia, these are great places to preserve the archaeological record. Places like San Francisco, places like here, New York, it's a terrible place to preserve because it's not hot enough. Sorry, it's not cold enough. It is not that dry, but it's also not that humid enough to maintain the things that well. Okay. So actually, in a lot of the places I mentioned, like Siberia, for example, Siberia is famously, well, at least in the paleontology world, famously like the where most of our if you like want to buy what's it called, like mammoth tusks or whatever, it has like a lot of them there because again it maintained really well in that super cold environment, right? So it's no surprise that they do have mammoth tusks because it's so cold over there, right? Naturally dry, right? Dry Siberia is very dry, but also Arizona, and I only know this because I went there, but University of Arizona has a very, very strong archaeology department. And they usually focus on the Native American tribes that are in Arizona because, again, it's so freaking dry over there that, it preserves really well. Okay. Wet climates, that's, I don't know, it's just kind of obvious, but like, like places with like tar pits, you ever heard of La Brea tar pits? It's like a, now it's a museum, but that's where they, because there's a tar pit, a lot of things fell in and they preserved well and they were able to like bring them out and like, analyze them and stuff. It doesn't matter. Anyways, very cold, very dry, very wet climates are perfect for preserving the archaeological record. Okay. Transformational processes. Now, this is a very fancy way of saying the following things: cultural factors and natural factors, right? So cultural factors, such as looting or construction, are terrible, obviously, for the archaeological record, right? If you can imagine, like, I know that there's a lot of stories about this, like, these like professional thieves that steal all this nice stuff. So imagine you're an archaeologist, you find this like tomb of a previous like governor or something like that, or someone that's high up in the government, and they have all these jewels and everything in their tomb. People will hire people to get those things from you, right? And even though in the movies it's often like a fight for this and that, realistically it's not that hard to get the stuff because usually when you're finding stuff, you're not exactly hiring like, special forces to protect your items, right? You don't have the money for that. You just have like general security. But the people that those super rich people hire that collect these things are going to be like ex-CIA agents and all this other stuff. So them getting your stuff is quite easy, right? Another thing is like construction, right? That is actually the main factor why San Francisco and New York, aside from their climate, it's a terrible place for you to have archaeological records because there's always construction going on. If there's something in the ground and you like dig it up to make like a building, you better, it's a pretty clear result for the archaeological record. It's just gonna get broken up, right? So that's an easy one, okay? Natural factors though, such as animal activities, natural catastrophes, animal activities, any animal that digs, right? Moles, even dogs, gophers, whatever, Those things, they don't, when they're living in their environment, they don't care what's down there. They're just trying to make a home down there. So it's very easy for them to break things or to disconnect things from what they are and what they used to be, right? Natural catastrophes, also, it's probably easy to imagine, right? If there's a flood or an earthquake or a volcano eruption, anything, those are very easy ways to, for your stuff to break, right? Or for stuff in the ground to be messed up, basically, okay? So these are the preservation factors that you have to consider when you are doing archaeology. Okay. Now, how does this complicate the reconstruction of the past and why? So the reason why it's important to consider these things is because just because we can't find them doesn't mean they didn't exist, right? It just so happened that maybe this group of people made their, I don't know, made their art out of turtle shells. And turtle shells don't preserve that well in the area that they're living. And of course, they decompose, we can't find them anymore. It does not mean they didn't have turtle shells as jewelry. It just means that we couldn't find it because of the preservation factors. Okay. Good. How to find sites. So, how do actually, should, yeah, how to find sites. So, how do archaeologists find sites? Now, the first thing always is interviews, right? Interviews. Even though these people are not around anymore, the people that you're trying to research, there might be descendants of those people still around, right? And this specifically is referring to a lot of like Native American people or people who have been in that geographic place for generations, right? And even though they might not know exactly how they used to live back then, what they might know is, oh, my great 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 grandmother said they used to play in a river over there. And then you're like, oh, there's a river over there? I didn't even realize. And then you find an old map, you see, find the river, and then you might search around there and you might find something. Okay. Maps. When we say maps, we do not mean Google Maps. What we mean are like old style maps. The reason why is because old style maps, again, not Google Maps, it aside from directed you where to go, it also gave you a lot of information of what's there, right? And so some of our ancestors may have drawn maps that have that indicate where certain people are or where certain things are. And through those maps, you can find a site. Okay. Now, this next one, surveying, right? This is more, this is kind of like the next step. This is like you kind of have an idea of where stuff is. There are three surveying methods. One is pedestrian, two is aerial, and the third is geophysical. Pedestrian is literally just walking up and down. Aerial is using planes to identify indication of buried remains. So basically, like using a helicopter or a plane, right? And finally, geophysical is just using a machine to see buried remains. And that last one is more like a machine. If you guys have ever heard of a sonar, like in a submarine, where they basically how it works is they send out these waves. Right. And if something bounces back, that means something is there. Right. And that's when it beeps or whatever. That's when you see the dots on the submarine screen. Okay. And it's the same thing with this. You put a machine into the ground, it shoots out waves. And if something bounces back, that means there is probably something there. Right. Is it 100% accurate? No, but it is a tool that archaeologists use. Right. Now, pedestrian, aerial, and geophysical. Sorry, pedestrian, aerial are very interesting. Pedestrian is walking, right? So the advantage of walking is that you get to see a lot of details, right? So if there's something small on the ground, you'll be able to see it. The disadvantage is obvious, is that you can't cover that much ground in one day, or and it's just an inefficient way of moving, right? Aerial, however, is the opposite, right? Aerial is very efficient when you're moving, right? So like, for example, if you're studying like these massive runes or of something, that's when aerial might be helpful, right? Because you get to see like how big it actually is. Does it connect with something nearby? Whatever, right? However, it might be disadvantageous. It might be not so great for identifying the kind of smaller things that exist in the ground. Okay. So yeah, those are the two things to consider, right? Geographic information systems, database with a map-based interface. Geographic information systems is another way that people find sites. This is more modern, and it basically is a Google Maps, but for archaeology stuff only. Okay. So yeah, and also too, so the thing is, right, with aerial and geophysical, this is it takes, so It's hard to explain this because you guys are not in grad school, but like how these people get money to do this stuff, it's not like they have their own money, right? They have to apply for money from the university or through the university from these private foundations that's like, yo, I really want to find out more about this particular thing or these particular people. You get the money and great, you can do this stuff. In order for you to use a plane or a helicopter or a geophysical gadget, right? You need to already have kind of like an established like thing. Like it's not like, hey, I want to check out something. Let me get like, so and so, thousand tens or hundreds of thousands of dollars so I can get a freaking plane and get this freaking machine that no one, uses to identify stuff. So usually they already kind of have a established project and they've already found some stuff. It's just they want to do further research. Okay. So that's like a big that's like a big downside of aerial and geophysical is that you kind of already need to have an established amount of archaeological records in order for you to get those things. Okay. So, how to study sites? Excavation of a site consists of the systematic uncovering of the archaeological remains through careful removal of the matrix. Okay. What that means basically is that so excavation is the process that the archaeologist goes through. Digging stuff up. That's the simple way of saying it, right? But when you do excavation, when you dig stuff up, you have to be very careful, right? And the reason why is because excavation is always destructive, right? So if you think about a lot of stuff you find in the ground, the reason why it got preserved was literally because it is underground and you are now digging it up. So excavation is always going to be destructive. Now, that being said, how destructive is it going to be? That depends, right? It could be minimally destructive, but it's still going to be destructive. And that's why when what it's saying right here, careful removal of the matrix, what that basically means is that they have to remove, the dirt and everything in a very, very slow and careful manner. That's it. Okay. But that's why excavation is always destructive. It's because literally this thing has only held its shape or its integrity because it's been underground. And now you're digging it out of underground and you're putting it into, into the open elements. Excavation is always destructive. Okay. And it's because of that that documentation must be careful and thorough, right? Very careful and thorough, meaning that again, when you take it out of the ground, people will like hurry up, take a million different pictures, they'll write some quick descriptions of it, and then they'll start doing other things to it. Because again, you don't know. You could take it out of the dirt and it would fall apart in 5 seconds. You don't know. So it's important to get as much information with about it as quickly as possible so that it can, be recorded as accurately as possible. Okay. Recording of sites involves a three-dimensional grid system and stratified excavation, aka digging in layers. So again, when you're digging in the ground, it's not just digging with a shovel. You have to, because again, everything needs to be systematic and like very clearly detailed. What they do is they'll find like a big rectangle or whatever, a big square shape, and they'll dig 1 inch, 1 inch, 1 inch at a time so that everything is predictable. So when you do find something, you'll be like, oh, I found this 4 inches within the ground, blah, 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 blah. Okay. Not only that, but they also create a three-dimensional grid system, meaning that they have a drawing or a outline, a blueprint, if you will, of how they're going to dig into the ground. Okay. So categorizing. Cataloging involves classifying an object's shape, material, and function, assemblages or groups of artifacts and features from a particular time and place in a site. Archaeological cultures are constructed by grouping similar assemblages from many sites, right? So we find a bunch of stuff, let's say, archaeology, we just kind of went over that. We find a bunch of stuff. Now, how do we categorize it, right? What they end up doing is they find these things maybe that are in the same area and they believe it's from the same time and they put them into assemblages. And assemblages are the way that they catalog certain groups of people or they catalog certain groups of or artifacts or whatever, right? So, as I just mentioned, right, the assemblages are used to map similarities and differences across space. Now, this is the second one that's very interesting. Maybe mistakenly assumed to represent a real social group. So the problem with assemblages is sometimes things, as unpredictable as nature is, will end up in the same place. And what do I mean by that? I mean, let's say there's a group of people living here, and then they die, right? And then 150 years later, another group of people comes here and they die in the same place. Usually what happened, because it's only 100 years, and in nature, that's not very long, they will have all their archaeological stuff in the same place. And we will assume that these two people are one people because we found them in the same place, right? That is not true. And so that's it, then it becomes inaccurate information. Or sometimes, let's say, again, a group of first people died, and 500 years later, another group of people here died, right? Okay, great. But guess what? There's an earthquake, or there's erosion, or there's a flood, or something. And now, gee, they're both together. Now, again, this is a misinterpretation because when we find those two things, we're going to think that they're together, but in reality, they're not. So that is the kind of challenge of categorizing all that stuff. All right, so full circle. What is difficult about archaeology, right? The first thing is we talked about, right, was like finding the stuff. Okay. Finding the stuff is not easy. Number two, is that stuff going to preserve and last well during, in the last like 1,000 years or whatever, right? Is it going to last well on the ground? Because if it doesn't, it'll disappear and it will have a completely different understanding of what that society did or did not do. Okay. And finally, the last thing is, when we categorize things, it's very difficult because we don't necessarily know where it came from or when it came from in this case, right? Were they actually, even though we found this pot and this pan together, were they actually from the same society or were they not? Okay. And in the next lecture, I don't know, the next lecture, maybe the lecture after the next, we are also going to talk about the challenge of understanding what that thing is for. If I see something that's like a circular cylinder shape and I see a handle, I'm going to assume that's a cup. Right? But guess what? That could not be a cup. That could be a hat for all I know. But it's because of our own biases that we think it's a cup. And so that's another challenge about doing archaeological research. Okay? So that's pretty much it. Remember, the quiz three is due at the end of this week. Yeah, that's pretty much it. Quiz three through the end of the week. And if you have any questions, just shoot me an email at raymond.fong@kbcc.cuny.edu. Hope you guys have a nice day.